This video is for sections 112 and 113 of Hansen and Quinn's Greek and Intensive course. And in it, we'll talk about the interrogative pronoun and adjective tis, ti, and the indefinite pronoun and adjective tis, ti. You can find this information in Hansen and Quinn on pages 435 to 437. Let's start with the interrogative pronoun and adjective tis, ti. An interrogative, as I'm sure you know, means something that asks a question. So these are question words, and the main way to tell the difference between this tis, ti and the indefinite tis, ti is that the question word always has an accent. Let's learn the forms first. These are largely third declension forms, and there is one set for the masculine and feminine and one set for the neuter. And here they are. Tis ti, tinos tinos, tini tini, tina ti, and then in the plural, let me slow that down just a bit, we're going to get, forgot there are alternative forms of the genitive singular, two and two. And there are alternative forms of the dative singular, toe and toe, which, as you can see, look exactly like the article, so you'll have to have some context to tell you which is which. Let's move on to the plural. Tines, tina, tinon, tinon, tisi, tisi, and tinas, tina. So those are your forms with their accents. And the next thing to know is that they ask the question who or what when they are pronouns. That means when they are not modifying some other noun. I'm pointing out the accent on tis and both the nominative and the accusative ti because breaking the rules for accent that you know. If these interrogative pronouns or adjectives appear before another word, they do not change those acutes to graves, unlike the rules for accent that you knew. So they break that rule. You should also notice and be aware that tina can be the accusative singular in the masculine and the feminine, as well as the nominative or accusative plural neuter. So be aware of your context and remember that both things are a possibility. All three things are a possibility. Now, let's look at how to translate these when they are pronouns. In the nominative, tis in the masculine or feminine means who. In the genitive, it means whose as a question. In the dative, it means to or for whom. And in the accusative, it means whom. So if you've always been an English speaker who wonders what the difference is between who, whose, and whom, now you're going to know because it has to do with how the interrogative pronoun is being used in its sentence. And as you know, Greek expresses how to use a word, a noun, or a pronoun in its sentence by the use of case. And you can see just a little bit of English case endings in who, whose, and whom. In the neuter, we would say what, of what, to or for what, and what. English doesn't have separate plural forms, so in the nominative, we'll get who and what. In the genitive, whose and of what. In the dative plural, to or for whom and to or for what. And in the accusative, whom or what. Now, tis ti can also be an interrogative adjective, that is to say, something that's asking you to specify a particular noun. So, in that use, it is which or what. And the definitions in all the cases and numbers are going to be more like this. Which, as in which man or which woman. Of which, as in of which man or of which woman or of which council. To or for which and which. So in all of those cases, all of those instances, you're going to use the word which, and the interrogative adjective will be modifying in the same case number and gender another noun. In the neuter, we don't have to give a different English way of saying the interrogative because we still use what when we want to specify what neuter thing. So we would say what book or of what deed. And so I'm not going to give you separate definitions for that. But then in the plural for the masculine and feminine, again, it would be which women or of which democracies or two or four which gods or which goddesses do you worship? Okay, let's look at some more actual examples. Here we have tis tus angelus epemsen. So, interrogative pronoun, and we have a question. There's our pronoun, it's in the nominative, and so that means, of course, it is the subject of our sentence, and the translation is, who sent the messengers? It's a pronoun, it stands on its own, and it doesn't modify another noun in the nominative, so we'll simply use the English interrogative pronoun. Let's look at another example. Tenas epemsata. So here is our interrogative pronoun. It is masculine or feminine, accusative, plural. It doesn't modify another noun, so it's a pronoun, not an adjective. And so we're going to ask, whom did y'all send? Let's get to another example, tina epimsata. And again, now in the singular, that can be, whom did y'all send? Asking the question, trying to find out who it was. Now, remember that tina could also be the neuter plural nominative or the neuter plural accusative. Nominative doesn't make any sense because we're looking at a second person plural verb, so y'all has to be the subject. So it's probably, if we want this choice, the neuter accusative plural. And so the translation would be, in that instance, what things did y'all send? Or simply, what did y'all send? We can go on and see the genitive singular interrogative pronoun tenos with tenos biblion epemsata. And this asks the question, whose book did you send? The direct object of epemsata is biblion, correctly in the accusative. But tenos is the question that we're really asking. Whose book is it? Of whom is that book? And so that's the question that has the interrogative pronoun, genitive singular, for the possession. Now let's see what this looks like when tis or ti becomes an interrogative adjective. So here's our first example, tenas gunaikas epemsata. Here is our interrogative adjective. It's in the same case number and gender as gunaikas, and so it's modifying gunaikas. So we're not just asking whom did you send, but we're asking which women or what women did y'all send. It's trying to specify which women. It's asking the question as an adjective. Another example, ti biblion epemsata. There's the interrogative adjective that agrees with biblion this time. And so our translation is, which book did y'all send? In that case, we know that you guys sent a book, but we didn't know which one it is. And so we're asking which one. And one more example. Tenes stratiotai emachonta. Here is our interrogative adjective, masculine nominative plural, agrees with stratiotai, and so it's asking which soldiers were fighting. Okay, you'll find other examples and other drills to practice in Hansen and Quinn. So let's move on to the indefinite pronoun or adjective tis or ti. Here, notice that tis and ti do not have accents. They are enclitic. And that's the only difference in form between the two words. So let's look at those forms. They are tis ti, tinas tinas, tini tini, tina ti. By convention, when we give the paradigm of an enclitic word, we only put an accent on it if it has two syllables, and when we do that, we put it on the second syllable. So that's why you see these acutes here. But they disappear in actual use unless there's a reason by the rules for enclitics to have an accent on them. So really, you should be thinking about these as accentless until you get them in context. Just like the interrogative tis ti, the indefinite tis ti has alternative forms in the genitive singular and in the dative singular. Those you won't confuse for the article because they don't have accents. Now, if we move on to the plural, we get tines tina, tinon tinon, tisi tisi, and tinas tina. Again, same letters as the interrogative pronoun, but enclitic forms. That is to say, they rely on the accents of the word before them. They lean on the word before them. Once again, notice that the accusative singular, masculine and feminine, has the same form as the nominative and accusative plural of the neuter. For the indefinite pronoun, our default translation, if it's masculine or feminine, is going to be someone or anyone, and in the neuter, it's going to be something or anything. So let me show you some examples. In these examples, I'm going to use exactly the same Greek as we used in the interrogative pronoun and adjective examples, but this time without a question, but with an indefiniteness, an uncertainty that we're expressing with the enclitic form of tis and ti. So our first sentence is tus angelus tis epemsen. Here you can see the enclitic tis, masculine or feminine, nominative, singular, is the only nominative in the sentence. It's uncertain, it's indefinite, but it is the subject of the sentence. And so our translation will be, someone sent the messengers. Now, notice that tis has no accent. And following the rules for enclitics, which you'll learn in more detail elsewhere, because it follows a word that has an acute on the second to last syllable, nothing else has to happen, and the tis stays there without its accent. Let's go on. One thing Hansen and Quinn doesn't tell you explicitly, or at least not that I could find quickly, is that the enclitic, the indefinite tis ti, cannot appear at the beginning of the sentence. So although these examples will all be using the same words that we used in the interrogative pronoun and adjective examples, they'll be in a different order because for all of the questions, the pronoun or adjective appeared at the beginning of the sentence. But as enclitics, which must follow another word, the indefinite tis ti, will all appear later in the sentence. So our second example here is epempsata tinas. And here I left it a question because, of course, you can ask things with indefiniteness. And I showed you with that red accent what happens in this particular situation when you have an acute on the third to last syllable of the word before a two-syllable enclitic, you're going to add another accent to the word before. So that's what that red accent is before the tenas. It has been thrown there by the enclitic, you could say. But let's translate. We're still asking a question, but this time we're asking not about whom the object is, but We're asking instead about the action. So let me just show you what that means. Did y'all send someone? So here the question is about the action and isn't really asking who the someone is, but whether or not you sent it. So it's an indefiniteness. Did y'all send someone? Or I could have put, did y'all send anyone? Let's go on to our next example. Epemsate tina. Here I just made it a sentence again, a declarative sentence. And again, following the same enclitic rules that you'll learn in more detail elsewhere, the enclitic tina throws an accent back onto epemsate, which is that little red acute you have there. The translation for this is, y'all sent someone. We don't know who. We're not asking who. We're just saying that you guys sent somebody. Now remember again that tina could also be accusative or nominative neuter plural. So this could also mean y'all sent some things. We don't know what things, but y'all sent something. Let's go on. Biblion tinas epemsate. Y'all sent someone's book. We don't know who. We're uncertain about that. But y'all sent someone's book. And so there we have the enclitic tinas, the indefinite form of the genitive singular, masculine or feminine of tis ti. Here, you can see what happens when a two-syllable enclitic follows a word that has an acute on the second to last. Again, you'll learn these rules more thoroughly elsewhere, but what happens is it does get an accent actually on the word, and that is that red grav you see there on tenas. Now, all of these were indefinite pronouns. Let's move on to show you how to translate what the indefinite adjective does. Gunaikas tenas epemsata? Did y'all send some women? So here, tenas, well, first of all, it's enclitic, and by the enclitic accent rules, it's going to throw an acute back on that gunaikas, which has a circumflex on the second to last syllable. But it also agrees with gunaikas, two accusative feminine plural words. So tenas here is an indefinite adjective. It's saying that this sentence, this question, knows that there's some women, but doesn't know which ones they are. It's not asking a question about it. It's asking about who they are. It's simply asking if you sent some. In our next example, biblion ti epemsate, here the T is accusative, neuter, singular, agreeing with biblion, and it means y'all sent some book, or I could have said y'all sent any book. And in our last example, stratiotai tines emachanta, this time we're just saying some soldiers were fighting. We don't know who, but some soldiers were fighting. And there again you see tenes, the two-syllable enclitic, throwing back an acute onto that stratioti. And there you have a good start on learning how to use both the interrogative pronoun and adjective tis ti and the indefinite pronoun and adjective tis ti, the enclitic form. You'll practice lots more with your drills and sentences from Hansen and Quinn.